Well, Ambassador Verveer, it's an honor to talk to you. Thank you so much for being with us.
Well, thank you.
And why don't we start our conversation about your upcoming trip to Uzbekistan? You just said that you have been there in 1997.
Well, I'm really looking forward to it because I'm going first and foremost to participate in a conference on women and the economy for Central Asia, and we can talk about that. But prior to going to that, I'm going to be able to spend a couple of days in Uzbekistan. And I do so remember the trip I made there with then First Lady Hillary Clinton in 1997. And it was an extraordinary time to participate with young people, to visit some of the projects that women were running in terms of health and well-being and just playing leadership roles. And to be able to come back these years later and see how progress is developing, where women still see challenges as they do all over the world, but also where they're taking their positions and really making a difference. And we have several meetings lined up with many of the government officials, with those who are involved in the economy and commerce, as well as in the parliament. And I am really looking forward to a good exchange, to hearing firsthand from them, to listening, and hopefully to developing future collaborations between them and growing the friendship between our two countries on which so much really rests.
Economic Symposium for the Women of Central Asia and Afghanistan sounds very big, sounds very ambitious. What are you expecting, and who are you expecting to see at this event?
Well, you know, these are really important convenings, and I have learned over many years now how critically significant it is to bring women together from across the borders, across generations, across sectors, from positions of influence, to really begin to look at the challenges that they confront, not only in their own countries, but that are common to all of them. And we have been working in other parts of the world, and this focus is really an investment in the future, in women's economic possibilities. We know from truly a mountain of data today that in countries where there is less of a gender disparity on women's economic and political participation, for example, those countries are much more prosperous. They are much more economically competitive. We know from some of the top studies that have been done by think tanks and businesses that women run small and medium-sized businesses are absolute engines, accelerators, if you will, of GDP. They are growth makers because these businesses are jobs creators. And every country today is looking for ways to grow its economy. So we have this enormous potential in Central Asia and around the world that, if tapped, could really contribute significantly to stronger economies within countries and, of course, to a stronger world in many ways that would diminish some of the challenges that we all confront. So this is an opportunity to bring women from the countries together, including Afghanistan, who will be joining. They, of course, have very significant challenges, but yet women in Afghanistan are also making tremendous strides in small and medium-sized businesses. And then we know historically, and we know from experience in the region, that micro-enterprises that depend on small amounts of credit, they have lifted up the poorest of the poor, particularly women, who then can help their families and invest even a small part of their income to better their family situation, particularly educating their children or taking care of their health. So those investments go back into the economy. So for a whole lot of reasons, it is the right thing to do, and it is the smart thing to do. And I have no doubt that bringing these strong players from across Central Asia, women together, the agenda has been formulated with them in mind. There have been many soundings, if you will, discussions with future participants in this conference over many months to ask them what would be most useful, what would be most helpful, to ensure that they're also not just listening, but are part of the discussions and the presentations. So this will be a really participatory conference. And beyond that, we will have many outside players coming from the International Finance Corporation, from the European Redevelopment Bank, from Reconstruction and Development Bank, from other pivotal global institutions who can be partners in more significant ways, as well as private sector participants who are committed to making commitments to continue this. So it's a conference, yes, but it's not a one-shot deal. This is something that we see as the beginning of a longer-term process of collaboration and commitment going forward.
Well, you just mentioned some of the, you said that strong players from across the region. What kind of an impact do you think that the women leaders in Central Asia are making today? You have a female president in Kyrgyzstan, you have female speakers of parliaments in Uzbekistan and in Turkmenistan, and then you have a lot of female ministers across the region. When do you see their impact?
Well, you know, I think it's really important for women to be able to have a place at the decision-making table. It's not that women are better than men or men are better than women, but when we have, particularly in public policy, which government service represents, where decisions are being made about all of society, to have the talents, the experience, and the perspectives that women represent being a part of that, I think is really important. Now, in truth, this is more of a growing phenomena as opposed to one that's been longstanding. And I think one of the issues is always modeling, having women in positions where you can now see that it is possible. You know, obviously, as you said, a speaker in Uzbekistan or president in Kyrgyzstan, these are not insignificant positions. And others seeing that they can do an excellent job, that you can have women in these positions, that becomes a role model in many ways for many others. So I think that's one of the things we want to see. We obviously are putting great emphasis on economic participation, but political participation, economic participation are not divorced from each other. In fact, they're critical parallel arenas for women's empowerment and women's ability to really become agents of change in their own communities for the better.
Well, in Afghanistan, for the past 10 years, we have seen a lot of improvements. Things have gotten better for the women of that country, but they still face very, very harsh conditions. What is the United States doing to make sure that the advancement of women continues after the U.S. military leaves?
Well, that's an excellent question. And obviously, it's right on the mark because you're so right. If you were to look back at what was happening to women, particularly when the Taliban were committing the atrocities and all of those brutal acts and keeping girls out of school, there's been so much change over the last, you know, almost a decade now. And I think that's one of the reasons this is such a major issue for our country and so many others. Because women have made so much progress, they are absolutely critical to building the future of Afghanistan. And so to ensure that there's no pushback looms as something very important. The United States has been one of the most significant leaders in expressing the need for women's ongoing participation at all levels of Afghan society, not as a favor to women, as important as it is for women. But because it is absolutely essential, if there is going to be potential for peace, for an end to the conflict, for a better future, then it will not happen if women's voices are silenced or if women are marginalized. Whether women are at the very grassroots level or participating in higher levels of government, their voices are going to be essential to ensuring a future. And that's what one of the reasons they are participating in the Central Asia Symposium. One is they're a close neighbor. And secondly, they have much to learn from others in the region for the exchange of good practices, many of which they're already engaged in. So the United States is working very hard to ensure women's ongoing participation. Far more girls are in school today. Women are participating in agriculture programs, animal husbandry, other economic programs. Microcredit has been an extensive tool that has been adopted and made available. And growing and strengthening civil society and ensuring access to justice, all of these things come together. But they are very much a part of what is necessary to ensure a truly brighter future for Afghanistan and a sustainable peace and sustainable stability.
And so we can see that the funding will continue for those existing programs and
well,
for women's
development? Well, as you know, we are going through a transition. The president announced some of that in the last couple of weeks. The expectation is that funding will not be at the level that it once was, both in terms of the military component and the development component. But it will be very strong and it will be sustainable. And the whole hope is that it will be the kinds of investments that we call foundational investments. And women are a huge part of the foundation. So that whether it's in agriculture, whether it's in other parts of the economy, or whether it's in political participation, we now have some 25% of the parliament in Afghanistan is female, and in the last election, some 400 women were running for office. This has to continue if Afghanistan's future is one that will be more peaceful, more prosperous, and certainly where stability will be a strong part of the foundation of the country. So we will certainly continue. And one of the things now is to make those investments in the best way possible.
So you help them start and they should take on themselves.
Absolutely. You know, give people the capacity, you know, whether it is to learn how to fish and feed your family or whether it is to learn how to grow a business or to learn how to plant the best crops or to learn how to find a market or to run an organization that responds to the needs of the community. These things and so many more are what will be critical as Afghanistan goes forward, and it will be Afghans in the driver's seat, men and women, as they are and need to continue to be very significantly.
Well, good luck at the symposium.
Thank you so much.
Have a great trip.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you for talking to us.